Nice to meet you, Ben.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye, darling.
Hello, sir.
Oh, how do you do? Would you like to come and sit on my knee? Good. Oh, we come. There we are. Now then, what's your name?
Susan Elizabeth Walker. Mm-hmm. What's yours?
Mine? Well, I have lots of names. Kris Kringle, Santa Claus, Father Christmas, or Nicholas. If you were in Holland, I'd be Santa Claus. Or in Italy, La Befana. I have to speak many languages because, of course, I travel, as you know, a great deal. Suresh Givthvom Christvom. That's Russian. And Sikulu, Alger, Ya Noele. That's Swahili.
My mother's Mrs. Walker. She's director of special events for Kohl's.
Uh-huh.
She runs a parade.
Oh.
I know how this all works. You're an employee of Kohl's.
That is true.
But you're a very good Santa Claus.
Thank you.
Your beard stuck on real tight. Usually the store's Santa Claus whiskers are too loose.
Right.
Yours look realistic.
That's because they are real. You give them a tug. Woo! Are you convinced?
Mm-hmm.
Good.
This isn't the regular Santa suit, is it?
Oh, no. This is the real Santa suit.
In Matthew chapter 1, the scripture says, "Now this is how the birth of Jesus came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be with child through the Holy Spirit." In verse 21, the scripture says, "And she will give birth to a son, and you're to give him the name of Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." All of this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophets. "The virgin will be with child and will give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, God with us." The movie clip that you just saw is from one of the old classics. Anyone remember the name of that movie? Miracle on 34th Street. That's right. Now, if you were around in 1947, either Channel 4, 6, or 8, you know, and you had to watch it before midnight, before the TVs went to snow, if you're as old as me, black and white. But they did a remix in 1994, and so if you've not seen the movie, it is now in color, and you can go watch it. But if you know the storyline behind Miracle of 34th Street, Natalie Woods plays the little girl named Susan, and her mom has told her that she didn't believe in Santa Claus, and so the little girl was not going to believe in Santa Claus, and there's this whole conversation throughout the whole movie, do we believe? And I think there's some lessons we can take away from this idea, this idea of being a skeptic and not believing, and where's our faith? And, you know, the idea of the Christmas message is really, it's all about the miracles and what is it that we do believe in. Now, I don't know where you stand on this issue. I can tell you this, come January, when I look at my bank account, I'm sure that that old man is alive. You know, I'm sure Christmas happens. There's no doubt about it. You can just look at your checkbook and you'll agree with me. Someone said there's four stages for every man in his life. The first is just the idea that we believe in Santa Claus. The second is we don't believe in Santa Claus. The third is we become Santa Claus. And the fourth is you start to look like Santa Claus. So yeah, some of y'all know exactly what I'm talking about here. It is inevitable. And we need to be wrestling with the question. And so what I think would be fun for us to do is leading up to Christmas, there's four Sundays, Advent starts today, the four Sundays that we're leading up to Christmas, is to take some of these old holiday classics. In fact, I hope that you go home and watch this old movie. If you've never seen it before, go check it out. It's a great, I watched it myself this past week, and I forgot how good some of these old classics could be. But I want to take the holiday classic movies to help us better understand Christmas and the Christmas season and what it means. And I very much on purpose started with Miracle on the 34th Street because of the foundation of our Christmas message. The very foundation of what we believe is all about miracles. Amen? The miracles that happen at Christmas are important to our faith. And so when I'm reading Matthew chapter 1, many of us have heard that passage of Scripture every Christmas for as long as we can remember. And it's always hard on the preachers. Like, how can you breathe something fresh into Matthew chapter 1 in the Christmas story? Because we've heard it our whole lives, many of us. And so what I'd like to do is just take this first chapter of Matthew, maybe look at it from a different perspective, very much in light of the miracles that we see in the life of Jesus. Matthew is known for repeating many of the miracles of Jesus, especially Matthew is known for the Christmas story. And I believe these miracles are worthy. I think they're important to us. I think that they're just as important today as they were back then, because I believe the miracles of Jesus are still as relevant today as they ever have been. And so, you know, throughout the message, if I say something that you agree with, you have my full permission to say, that's right, oh yeah, amen, you know, let me know you're with me, right? I believe that the miracles that happened to Jesus back then are just as important today as they ever have been. There we go, all right. We're going to work on that this Christmas season. I love to get feedback. I know that you're with me that way. Now, if you're a note taker, I want to look at a few of the miracles from this text, Matthew chapter 1, if you have your Bibles, 18 and following, and just make a note of some of the miracles. The first miracle we know as the incarnate of Jesus, the miracle of incarnation. Now, at the risk of sounding a little sacrilegious, let me say this about our faith, that there are quite a few things in the Bible as we read it that are a challenge for normal people to accept, or maybe even a challenge for us to believe that it's even possible. That there are things that happen in the Bible that we have not seen. Many of us have not seen in our lifetime or experienced. And so we accept some of these things through our faith. And if we didn't have faith, there's a lot of things we would read like, I don't know about that, Faust. I'm not so sure about that story. If we didn't have faith, we would struggle with some of these miracles. If you watch Miracle on 34th Street this next week, you're going to hear the conversation between mom and daughter, and they're trying to convince young Susan, listen, some things don't make sense. And they say, faith is believing even when things don't make sense. And we need that, and we need to understand that truth in our life. I mean, you take the idea of creation. One day, right? One day that everything, just one sentence in Genesis, and it was created. God said, and it was. That's certainly something that we don't see every day in our lifetime, creation and birth. Think about the Red Sea, when the Israelites were pressed up against the Red Sea and the Lord caused a path and the winds blew back the waters and they crossed over the Red Sea, the Israelites did, on dry land. I mean, think about the speed of a tornado and the mighty wind of a tornado could not have done what we believe happened that day for the Israelites. And somewhere in the list of all of these miracles that maybe you've heard and seen in your lifetime, somewhere in all of those miracles, you have to include the resurrection. We just sang about it. And you think about the resurrection. We've seen it on TV and people revived and brought back to life. If you work in public safety, maybe you've personally seen someone resurrected. But 3 days dead in the tomb? We've not seen that, have we? It's not something we've personally experienced, but we know that's what Jesus did. When you look at our text this morning, it contains some of those challenges that we're faced with to believe that which is abnormal, to believe that which is uncommon, things that just don't make sense to us. And so you look back at the 18th verse, and it says, Mary was found to be with child, highlight, underline, circle, through the Holy Spirit. Now think about that for a moment. Now I think it's interesting, if you keep reading the text, Matthew very quickly replies following that, mentions that it was not Joseph's doing. Mary was found to be with child through the Holy Spirit. This is called the miracle of incarnation. That God wanted to become a man, he clothed himself in flesh. This is an abnormal, uncommon thought process. It is a miracle of Christmas. Now, You know as well as I do, that's not something we see every day. It goes against common sense. We all know how babies enter the world, right? Dads, we all accept the responsibility that there's one day we're going to have the talk. That my dad had the talk, I had the talk, there's the talk. And there's a lot of tension in that. Dad's palms get sweaty, we break out in a... And you don't want to have it too soon, and you don't want to have it too late. You know that you've had it too late if the kid is finishing your sentences for you and has to explain something that dad didn't fully understand. You might have missed the party. It's a little bit too late. But you could also go too early. The story's told of a dad, and he's like, it's time to sit down. We're going to have the talk. And so they're having the conversation, and dad's telling in detail what he thinks is most important to the message. And as he's telling the story and giving all the details about how babies come into the world, the little boy's eyes getting bigger and bigger and bigger. Finally, the boy's like, no way. That's probably a sign dad was a little too early with the talk. Now, as I was preparing for the message, and I'm reading the miracles of Christmas, and I'm in Matthew chapter 18, or Matthew chapter 1, when I get to verse 18, Mary was pregnant through the Holy Spirit, I have to stop and say, no way! That is too hard to believe. And yet we know it as the miracle of incarnation. That the birth of Jesus is unnatural. The birth of Jesus is unexplainable. The birth of Jesus is unequaled. And it defies common sense. Yet, we believe. We believe that God became flesh, became man, and dwelt with us, walked with us, lived with us. And the manner in which God brought His Son Jesus into this world was for the purpose of saying, my child will grow up and he'll do the things that no one else could do and no one else can explain. That's why they're miracles. That he's the man who faced death and won. That one day he will return someday to totally destroy all evil that's in the world. Amen? You understand? Let me say it again. One day this man Jesus, who faced death and won, will return someday to totally destroy all evil in the world. Absolutely. We got to get on board with that in our Christian faith. That's the message. That's the point of all of this. That if he was born and died and he did all the things that we believe he did, listen, what problem did you drag through the door today that he can't possibly handle? If he did the things that we believe he did, what problem do you have that's too big for him? It's the miracles of creation, the miracle of incarnation. That's why Christmas is good news. It's so much more, listen, please. It's so much more than presents and parties and people. It's also about the power of God to be able to do something that which is impossible. And we need to embrace that this Christmas season. I want to encourage you to add that aspect to your Christmas. Yes, parents and people and presents and parties are good things, but what about the power that God could do something impossible? It's the miracle of Christmas. Whatever challenges you're facing in life today, please know that He has a proven record to overcome anything that you're wrestling with, that He can do what we can't. That's the miracle of incarnation. Let me give you another miracle. Look at verse 21. It's the miracle of innocence. Verse 21, we see the miracle of innocence. Let that word sink into your mind for a moment. What do you think of when you think of the innocence of a child? And in your mind, you see the picture, baby wrapped in swaddling. Some of y'all have little babies now. I was watching Ezra, our worship minister, David and Kelly had their little baby in a car seat over here. Kelly's like, hey, will you watch Ezra while he never budged? Sleeping, beautiful, quiet, innocence. At Christmas, you're going to spend more time with family. And some of y'all are going to look across the room and the kids will be playing. It'll be that cute little girl, just as sweet as can be, innocent as can be, right? You look on past the little girl, and there's some bigger boys. They got guilt written all over their face because you know those boys are up to something. No good. We can just look across the room, and we can tell. And that's hard for us. You think about how hard it is to get your innocence back. You see a little kid who's innocent, and you see these boys running around who are up to no good. That's hard for us as parents and grandparents because of that truth. How hard is it when you lose your innocence, how hard is it to get it back? That's the idea of the Christmas miracle, the innocence of Christmas in Christ. You think about in the very beginning, Adam in Genesis, the world was perfect, the garden was perfect, and Adam decides to eat of the fruit. And what does he do? He runs and he's hiding, he's ashamed. Because of sin. So God calls them on that. What are you boys up to? Eve made me do it. Right? Eve gave me the fruit. Do you see this play out in your families? You see this play out with kids? How hard is it when we lose our innocence? And I want you to think about that. This second miracle that we're looking at here, it explains the process of getting our innocence back. So jot some notes down on this. And I want you to notice in the text, it's Joseph who's given the responsibility to give the baby a name, and his name will be Jesus. And that wasn't a name he pulled out of the hat. In both Jewish and Greek culture, we know the name Jesus means literally to save, right? To bring back innocence. That's his role. That's what Jesus is doing. You look in verse 21, and you see the life purpose of the child was to save the people from their sins. Innocence. You and I know that in 3 decades, this baby will go to the cross and he will become the punishment for all of the sins of the world. And anyone who embraces Christ is declared innocent by God. And God's approach to eliminating sin in our lives is described typically in 3 ways. This is not in your notes, it's free, but jot it down. It's a whole nother sermon, but let me give it to you anyway. The process that God uses to eliminate sins in our life, he covers our sin. We know that we wear the righteous robes, is some of the language. Our sins are covered because of Christmas. He cleanses us of our sins. That you think about the washing. What can wash away our sins? Nothing but the blood. Absolutely. Our sins are covered, our sins are cleansed, and because of Jesus and Christmas, our sins are canceled. Again, a whole nother sermon. But it's as if it didn't happen, that he remembers them no more. Folks, that whole story is the story of the miracle of innocence. It's how we declare, it's how we get our innocence back. It's the very heart nature of God to cover and cleanse and cancel our sins. Now, folks, that is why this is important. The innocence is the one thing Christian people have that non-Christian people don't. Don't miss this. Christian people might be successful at their jobs, but non-Christian people can be excellent at what they do. That Christian people can have great marriages and beautiful kids. But guess what? Non-Christians can have great marriages and beautiful kids. That Christian people might be blessed with exceptional health. But guess what? Non-Christians can have exceptional health as well. And when you boil it all down, when it comes right down to it, the one definitive characteristic that distinguishes us as believers from those in the world who do not believe, it is the truth that God sees us and declares us innocent of our sin in his sight. That's the only difference between those who are followers of Christ and those who aren't. God declares us innocent in his sight, not because of what we've done, but because of what Jesus has done for us. The miracle of incarnation. The miracle of innocence. Let me give you one more miracle. If you're taking notes, it's in verse 23. It's the miracle of indwelling. You know, people ask every Christmas, Lee, I don't know, all this Christmas stuff, all the hoopla, all of the presents, can it just be wrong? Is it wrong to do all of this at Christmas? Is it wrong to buy all the presents? Where do you stand on that? And I'm like, well, I don't see how buying Christmas gifts at Christmas can be wrong, especially if you're buying them for me, right? How can that be wrong, right? How can it be wrong to show thanks and to be generous and to give gifts? How can that be wrong? Well, it does get out of hand. You know, I also teach Dave Ramsey. And so I know Christmas can get way out of hand. That's next week's movie. Come back next week, Christmas at Vacation. If you ever saw it, you know how wrong Christmas can go, how we can go way overboard for Christmas. But listen, the whole idea of expressing ourselves, our love and our thanks to other people through giving gifts cannot be wrong when it's done appropriate, when it's done within our means, right? The story's told about this couple. They were walking through the mall and they were talking about all the gifts. And the wife says, "Well, you know, honey, we haven't bought mom a gift for Christmas." And so the husband says, "Well, I don't know what she likes. What does she like?" "Well, I don't know. She likes electrical things." And he said, "Well, how about a chair?" I was with my in-laws all this past week, so I'm just kidding. I have wonderful in-laws. They feed me. They love me. They're wonderful people. Now, that could be not so appropriate, right? The gifts could be, but the whole thing, when it's done healthy, when it's done right, with the best attitude within our means, Christmas and the giving of gifts is a beautiful thing. Now, I'm saying all of that because when I talk about this last miracle, the text suggests the greatest gift that we could ever receive. Jesus born to die, absolutely. But you think about this gift, this indwelling. God wants to be with you. That could be the greatest gift that we ever receive, is God desires to be in a relationship with us. In fact, someone said, God wants a relationship with you more than you want with Him. And I think that's true. I think that's why He's pursued us so hard, to clothe Himself in flesh, to come in and on earth, to be near us. Folks, the Christmas story is proof that this child whose name will be Emmanuel, what does that mean? God with. Jesus was His name, but He had a lot of titles and character qualities. This idea, Emmanuel, God with, that speaks to the function, the character, to the life of Jesus. And when Jesus was brought into this world, it was God's way of saying, hey, I don't want to be distant. That I want to be near you. I want to be with you. I want to dwell with you. And this desire of God continues. Even when Jesus left this earth, remember right before He leaves, He goes to His followers and to His disciples. He said, I got to go. And they're like, we're going with you. He's like, no. Where I'm going, you can't. He says, but I won't leave you alone. I'll send you. Right? Go to Jerusalem. Don't leave. I'm going to send my comforter. He's talking about the Holy Spirit. You see, God wants to be with His children, with His people. And so that day of Pentecost, Peter gets up and preaches. And he's preaching, and people accept Jesus, and they're baptized into Jesus. And the scripture says, Peter, what should we do to be saved? Repent. Be baptized, and what's it say? And you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit, His indwelling. The same God who created this world and owns everything in it, do you realize He has your life as His address? Your life is the residence, the address that Jesus, through His Spirit, lives in us. It's a beautiful picture of baptism, to be united with Christ in His death, burial, and resurrection. I love the old story. If you've not ever read anything by Bret Hart, he's an old storyteller from the Civil War. And in his book entitled The Luck of the Roaring Camp, paints a beautiful picture of what we believe of Jesus and the miracle of Christmas. He's writing a story about the Roaring Camp. It was the meanest, it was the toughest of all the mining camps. It was like a horrible place to live. It was inhabited entirely by men, but one woman of questionable character, if you know what I mean. Her name was Cherokee Sal. And one year she got pregnant, and she died while giving birth. And so these gruff old men, took this little baby, put it in an old box with some rags. One of the guys didn't think it looked right or appropriate that this baby would be in a box with a bunch of old dirty rags. So he got on his horse and he rode 80 miles to come back with this rosewood cradle built just for the baby. Another one of the old timers thought the dirty rags didn't go with the rosewood cradle. So he drives the next town over, rides over, and he gets the silken blankets. And then they realize this beautiful cradle and silk blankets are in this dusty, dirty old house. So they start cleaning up the floor. And from the floors, they're like, well, we better do the windows. Now we do the windows, and they need curtains. They get the house clean. They look around. All these smelly old men's like, well, they start taking a few more baths. Started shaving a little bit more frequently. Started watching their language around the baby. Hey, if you're going to do that, take it elsewhere. And the parties move from their house to another. And you can see this evolution. And so one night they're sitting out on the front porch. It's just peaceful and quiet. And out of the quietness, someone breaks the silence and says, you know, that baby has changed everything. And isn't that true? That baby has changed everything. That's the miracle of Christmas. And when you look at the birth of Jesus, I know that I've got a God who can do the impossible. I've got a God who takes away all my sin and guilt and shame. That I have a God who wants to be with me and near me, Emmanuel, God with. And it's because of those miracles and the miracles of Christmas that my life has never been the same. That baby has changed everything. And I pray that's true for you. I pray you experience that this Christmas. Father, as we pray before you, Lord, we thank you so much for your son, Jesus. We thank you for the difference that he's made in our life. That baby changed everything. It's turned this whole world upside down. God so loved the world that he gave the most precious gift of his son. And whoever might believe in him, accept, have the faith, even when it doesn't make sense, whoever would believe in him would not die, but have everlasting life. Oh, Father, we thank you for the miracles of Christmas. We thank you for your son, Jesus, who makes it all possible. It's in his name we pray. Amen.